On Tech News Today, Google announces three new Nexus devices and tells us what the next version of Android's L word is. Plus, the plot thickens in the ongoing drama over Apple's Sapphire partner GT Advanced Technologies. And it finally happened, the world's first documented case of Google Glass addiction. All that and more coming up right now.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Tech News Today is provided by CashFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Tech News Today for Wednesday, October 15th, 2014. This episode is brought to you by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create your own professional website or online portfolio. For a free two-week trial and 10% off, go to squarespace.com and use the offer code TNT. And by Prosper. Prosper is a peer-to-peer lending marketplace which connects people who are looking to borrow money with those who have money to lend. Visit prosper.com/twit and receive a $50 Visa prepaid card when you get a loan. Tech News Today is the show where we talk about the tech news with the journalists who report it. Welcome to the show. I'm Mike Elgan, and Jason Howell, today's the big day.
Yeah, apparently it is. Although I've been frantic all morning, so I've had little time to ingest the information. Today's the big day.
Yes, and of course, I'm not, of course, talking about the new hardware. I'm talking about the fact that they named the L word. It's Lollipop.
Yay! Well, that's kind of what we were, you know, it was circling around that. And there was even a leak from the Chromium tracker. Someone had posted a screenshot to the Chromium tracker of an Android interface with a little Lollipop icon up there that Google then later in the day pulled. So it was kind of like, all right, that's got to be it. So there we go.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, let the operating system for suckers jokes begin.
Exactly.
It was kind of ill-advised, but it is refreshing, I think, that they have a code name that isn't the result of a sort of a licensing deal with a company. You know, I thought maybe Lifesavers, they make a deal with the Lifesavers people, but
I wouldn't count that out entirely, like going forward. We might see that again.
That's right. Well, let's jump into the news. Google unveiled three new Nexus devices today. Google's new $649 Nexus 6 smartphone, made by Motorola, the $399 Nexus 9 tablet, made by HTC, and a $99 Nexus player for TVs, made by Asus Tech. And Rolf Winkler in the Wall Street Journal said these are designed and priced to compete against Apple. For example, the phone and tablet are priced much higher than previous Nexus models. All three devices can be pre-ordered later this week. The phone and tablet will go on sale in dozens of countries next month. The tablet and player will also work with optional keyboard and game controllers, respectively, and they all run Lollipop. I got to get used to saying that. Tune into This Week in Google today at 1 p.m. Pacific, 4 p.m. Eastern for a lot more details. I'm sure they'll have lots and lots to say about all these announcements. Well, Google researchers have discovered a bug in SSL 3.0 that could enable hackers to hijack user accounts for banks, email, and other services. And they named it Poodle for Padding Oracle on Downloaded Legacy Encryption. Great name. Dennis Fisher is a journalist who specializes in security and wrote about Poodle for ThreatPost. Welcome to you, Dennis Fisher.
Thanks for having me.
Now, how would a Poodle attack work exactly?
So there's a couple of requirements that have to be in place for the attacker to be able to execute this. Most importantly, the attacker needs to have control of the network that the victim is on. So typically, this would be sort of a man-in-the-middle situation where, you know, you're sitting in a coffee shop or an airport and you're using a public Wi-Fi hotspot and an attacker has been able to take control of that hotspot. So he can, intercept the traffic between you and whatever destination you're trying to reach. So SSL was designed in part to protect against things like that. So it encrypts the traffic between you and the web server on the other end. And the attack that the guys at Google developed allows an attacker, if he can get some JavaScript to run in your browser and then force your browser to make, you know, several hundred requests over a certain period of time, he can slowly decrypt the traffic between you and the server, which is, you know, obviously not what the protocol was designed to do.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, man in the middle attack is the name of that type of attack, and it's been around for a long time. I think it's kind of sexist. It should be person in the middle. I think it discourages young girls from getting into the malicious hacker business. But what can IT admin and users do to protect themselves against this? It sounds like there isn't a whole lot they could do right off the bat, is there?
On the user side, the best thing you can do is to use an up-to-date browser. So at the same time that the Google researchers announced this attack yesterday, they also announced that Chrome, the most recent version of Chrome, has a protection in place for this that prevents web servers from forcing the client to fall back to an older protocol, such as SSL 3.0. Mozilla is going to disable SSL 3.0 by default by the end of next month as well. It's really up to site operators, though, the guys running the web servers, to disable it on their end so that the clients don't try and use that protocol when they connect. The only modern, you know, if you want to call it modern browser, major browser, that still doesn't have anything more secure than SSL 3.0 in it is IE6, which, you know, as you know, it's really old. You shouldn't be using it anyway. And, you know, hopefully this attack will, if nothing else, kind of drive a stake through IE6.
Now, how does this compare to Heartbleed and Shellshock?
They're completely different. I mean, on the scope of seriousness, I would say that Heartbleed was probably the more serious of those three. It affected such a wide range of servers and clients. And, you know, very quickly after the announcement was made, there were active attacks using Heartbleed going on right away. You know, Shellshock also extremely serious, and it also affected a wide range of software. You know, pretty much every version of Linux has Bash in it, which is the vulnerable component. And, you know, the Poodle attack is sort of a follow-up to some older crypto attacks against SSL that have come out in the last 3 or 4 years, like Beast and Crime. They all sort of have some very specific requirements in order to execute them. And there's various ways that you can protect against them. But, you know, in terms of things that users need to worry about in their everyday lives, you know, Heartbleed was probably at the top of that list of those three.
Now, has a Poodle attack actually occurred yet, or is this all just theoretical?
There's no real way to know. I haven't heard anything yet about active attacks using this, but that certainly doesn't mean anything. You know, there's no real way to tell whether this was discovered independently by attackers, you know, weeks or months or years ago, and they've been using it. But the Google folks that disclosed it yesterday didn't mention anything about active attacks. So, you know, we just have to sort of hope that there haven't been yet. And as I said, you know, in order to execute this attack, it has some highly specific requirements, and there's easier ways for attackers to get what they want from a user. You know, simply getting a piece of malware or a keylogger onto a user's machine, in a lot of cases, will get them the banking credentials that they're probably after anyway.
Dennis Fisher writes at threatpost.com, and you can follow him on Twitter at Dennis F. Thanks for joining us, Dennis Fisher.
Thanks so much for having me.
All right. In just a sec, we're going to check in on major drama over Apple and its Sapphire manufacturing partner. But first, I want to tell you about Squarespace. Squarespace is a beautiful place to build a beautiful website, and I highly recommend that you do it. No matter who you are or what you do for a living, you really should be building a website, either a blog. I recommend that everybody blogs. It's just a fantastic idea. If you've ever read my columns on this topic, it's just a great thing for everybody to do. But if you're a professional, want to promote your work, or if you have a small business, no matter what it is that you do, you should have a blog, and you should have a good blog. Don't have a lousy blog. Don't have an average blog. Have an exceptional blog, and you can do it so easily with Squarespace. Starting with their 25 beautiful templates and their logo creator tool, you can construct very easily something that looks like a whole team of brilliant designers were involved with, and of course they were involved in the back end, but in terms of your involvement, you can just go in there and use the tools that are there, and it just happens almost by itself. It's so easy to do. Now, of course, if you read the Steve Jobs biography, he talked about how his father taught him to not only have the front of the fence look good, but also make sure the back of the fence looks good as well. And of course, that's Squarespace's philosophy as well. Their code looks beautiful. These beautiful websites are backed up by beautiful code. Squarespace takes as much pride in their back-end code as they do their front-end design. And if you're a coder and you want to go in there and do things by hand, that's great, and you'll really appreciate what you'll find inside. Of course, it's mobile-ready. The Squarespace Metric app for iPhone and iPad lets you check site stats like page views and manage your blog. Start a free 2-week trial today with no credit card required and start building your website. When you decide to sign up for Squarespace, make sure you use the offer code TNT to get 10% off. We thank Squarespace for their support of Tech News Today. The drama over the apparent fallout between Apple and its Sapphire manufacturing partner, GT Advanced Technologies, continues. The U.S. Justice Department wants to know why GT filed for bankruptcy only 10 months after making a lucrative deal with Apple. With us is Phil Goldstein. Welcome to you, Phil.
Thanks for having me, Mike.
Now, why does GT want to close its plants, and how would that affect Apple?
Well, they filed for bankruptcy protection on October 6th, and they say they're going to close down their plants in Mesa, Arizona, and then in Massachusetts. They're going to cut 890 jobs. As far as I can tell from the court filings that have come out and the reporting that we at Fierce Wireless and others have done on the bankruptcy proceedings since the filing was made, Apple was going to make these prepayments to GT Advanced, $578 million worth in the form of a series of loans, basically. But the payments were contingent upon GT Advanced meeting certain technical and financial milestones set by Apple. And apparently those milestones were not met. There was a huge sell-off in the stock the day that GT Advanced filed for bankruptcy. There's been a lot of concern about what some insiders at GT Advanced might have done in terms of selling stock, which we can get into. But basically, they're in a really tough place right now financially. And unfortunately, because of a lot of the confidentiality agreements that have been struck between Apple and GT Advanced, we don't yet know a lot about the inner workings of their relationship and why there was this very precipitous downfall for GT Advanced.
Now, this fine or penalty, I guess, that Apple imposes on its partners, that's kind of universal for Apple partners, isn't it?
As far as we can tell, GT Advanced didn't specifically name Apple when it was talking about this penalty, but they're the obvious party. And basically, what they said in court filings, I believe last week, was that they would be fined $50 million for each instance of them divulging a secret about Apple's products or Apple's business processes. Apple's obviously a notoriously secretive company, but these details spilling out into the open give us, I think, a greater understanding of just how seriously Apple takes secrecy with its manufacturing partners.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, we also heard today that one of the executives for GT was caught selling shares after the company fell behind on Sapphire production schedule. That would be Dan Squiller, I guess his name is. He's the CEO of GT. He knew the stock would tank when the word got out, so he sold $1.2 million worth of stock way back in May, and then it arranged for the sale of another $750,000 worth of stock leading up to the October 6th bankruptcy filing. That sounds pretty illegal to me.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a securities expert. I'm not a financial regulation expert, but it does sound like the timing of these sell-offs, both by Squiller and I believe by other executives at GT Advanced, is a little fishy in terms of how coincidental it was. I believe that the CEO of the company, Thomas Gutierrez, I'm seeing reports, sold shares on September 8th, which was the day before the iPhone 6 announcement. And there's been a lot of speculation leading up to that announcement that the new iPhones were going to have Sapphire displays. And they obviously were announced without Sapphire displays. And GT Advanced basically had this factory that Apple had purchased and then leased to them in Arizona. And Apple was the exclusive client that they were going to be producing Sapphire for at that plant. So it's unclear, I think, at this point, why the new iPhones did not have Sapphire screens when so many analysts thought that they would, and whether or not that's related to whether GT Advanced fell behind, basically, in meeting the technical milestones that Apple had set for it.
It seems pretty catastrophic for Apple, because they had been, you know, this whole idea of the Sapphire screens for their phones has been a major differentiator coming into the launch of the iPhone 6. And now it seems like those plans are kind of scuttled. What are they going to do for Sapphire? When do you think we're going to see Sapphire on Apple phones?
I'm not sure about when it's going to be on phones. They have said that the Apple Watch, which is supposed to come out, I guess, in the first quarter of 2015, is going to have a Sapphire display, but it's unclear whether or not that Sapphire is going to come from, you know, production from GT Advanced or from some other partner. In terms of the phones, I think that it's going to require Apple to have a manufacturing partner, whether it's GT Advanced or somebody else, that can really produce these Sapphire displays at very high volumes. Apple obviously said that they sold 10 million units of the iPhone 6 and 6 Plus in the first weekend of sales. There have been reports that they want to, you know, have their supply chain partners produce 70 to 80 million units by the end of 2014. So if we're talking about unit volumes in the tens of millions of units, and each one of those is going to have a Sapphire display, you really have to have either, you know, a single production partner that can churn out those screens at very high volumes very consistently, or you have to have multiple partners that can allow you to do that.
What does the global Sapphire market look like right now? Is the industry sort of ramping up to add Sapphire, or is Gorilla Glass going to be with us for a long time? What's it going to look like in a year or two when all this shakes out?
That's definitely not my area of expertise. I would say that from what I know, you know, Kyocera has been putting Sapphire displays into their phones for a while. They're obviously not a huge player in the global smartphone market, but they have expertise in Sapphire. You're seeing it kind of come into some more high-end models. I believe Huawei recently announced that one of their new models is going to have a Sapphire display. I think that until this can be, you know, until the production of Sapphire displays can be ramped up significantly in, you know, very high mass quantities, it's not really going to become a mainstream screen technology or differentiator. It'll be perhaps in a few high-end niche models, but I don't think that you're going to see, you know, a year from now, every new smartphone have a Sapphire display.
Phil Goldstein is at fiercewireless.com, and you can follow him on Twitter at fiercewireless. Thanks for joining us, Phil.
Thanks for having me, Mike.
Chip giant Qualcomm today agreed to buy the UK chipmaker CSR for about $2.5 billion. CSR is a major Bluetooth wireless technology company, and this looks to be a play for the Internet of Things. The CSR board approved the sale unanimously, and the company's stock rose 33% in early morning trading. The deal is subject to regulatory approval. Mozilla yesterday unveiled something called the Humble Mozilla Bundle, which lets you play games in a browser without downloads or plugins. The games can be played in any WebGL-compatible browser, so that includes Firefox and Chrome. And for the next 2 weeks, users can pay whatever they want for DRM-free versions of a handful of games. The bundle and the pay-what-you-want deal is the result of a partnership between Humble Bundle and Mozilla. And in a follow-up, speaking at a Time Warner investor meeting today, HBO CEO announced that the company plans to start selling a digital online subscription package that doesn't require a pay TV subscription. Yay!
Finally.
Yeah. The new offering is expected next year.
And it'll be ridiculously expensive, I'm guessing.
Of course it will, but it'll be there.
It'll exist. It'll be an option.
Yeah, finally. Reuters reported an exclusive this morning that after months of negotiating, HP has ended merger talks with EMC. The news could be announced as early as today. Well, in just a sec, we're going to tell you about a horrible new affliction that one man has come across. But first, I'm going to tell you about Prosper. Prosper is a service that lets you borrow money from people who want to lend money. You don't want to borrow from a bank, and sometimes you don't want to crowdfund everything if you have a project. Maybe you want to consolidate your debt, and that's something that I highly recommend you do with a Prosper loan. You can get, in 72 hours, you can get have a $35,000 loan to cover your needs. And one of the best things you can do is pay off the higher interest credit cards and other debt that you have, and that will save you a ton of money. It's like free money because you're essentially borrowing money at a much lower rate. Prosper offers low fixed rates, unsecured personal loans, no collateral required, and has multi-year terms available. Prosper has more than 2 million members and has over $1 billion in funded loans, which is just awesome. Just go to prosper.com/twit to check your rate instantly without affecting your credit score. Very important. For a limited time, Prosper is offering Twit viewers a $50 Visa prepaid card when you get a loan. Go to prosper.com/twit, and that's a special rate just for our viewers. Up to $35,000 in just 3 days and a $50 Visa prepaid card. Go to prosper.com/twit. In other news, a new study reveals that a man is being treated for Google Glass addiction, the first known case. The man, whose name was not given in the study, was admitted into the Navy's Substance Abuse and Recovery Program for alcoholism. But before being admitted, he'd been wearing his Google Glass headset for 18 hours a day. He removed it only to sleep and, unlike Robert Scoble, to bathe.
So I have to imagine he did the whole battery pack plugged into, you know, like routed out and into his pocket somewhere to do this. I don't understand how you get addicted to Google Glass. I mean, I suppose people can get addicted to pretty much anything these days. It's just part of human nature. Wow, that's interesting. I never thought I'd see that.
Yeah. Doctor said that it took him up to 35 days for him to stop reflexively poking and swiping at his temple. And they said he continued to have dreams, quote, as if looking through glass, unquote.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. Smartwatches are coming out of the woodwork these days, and most of them do similar functions, notifications, that kind of thing. But a new $139 smartwatch called Clats, it's actually called Dot Clats for some reason, is being crowdfunded on Kickstarter and does something unique. Jason, let's check out the video. So here we see the scenario, that the nightmare scenario that we all have here in the first world. Can't answer the phone. So what we're seeing is a woman is scrambling to find her phone in her purse.
Oh, no.
Yeah, Mr. Cool is just sitting there smugly sort of chuckling at her.
Is this you?
Gosh, I guess I couldn't do it. Well, there we go. Oh, I missed
the call.
Didn't get
to it.
Darn it.
Yeah, too late.
Now Mr. Cool gets a call. On his gigantic bracelet, he rips it off and answers it. It opens up like a clamshell, looks like the letter 3, and he uses it as a handset.
Okay. Wow. All right.
I don't know.
So, you funding this?
No. You know, actually,
I suppose it's something new.
Yeah. It is. There's been so many of these kinds of things to figure out how to get this kind of thing going with some sort of wearable device. But
right.
Yeah, I don't see it happening. Well, our TNT fan of the day is Steve Burkett in New York City, who said he listens to Tech News Today with a Crucial coffee and a trusty combination of Stitcher and his Surface Pro 3. He says, great show. Thank you.
Thanks.
We appreciate that. Yeah. Nice to hear. And look at that. Look at that. He needs a Tech News Today mug.
Yeah, I was frantically during the Prosper ad scanning this image, trying to find where the video player was. I was like, oh, wait a minute. He's listening to us. That's right. That's how the majority of people enjoy the show.
That's right. Well, how do you watch or listen to TNT? Just record a video or take a picture of your setup and post it on Google+, Twitter, or Facebook, and use the hashtag #HowIWatchTNT, and we will find it. And that is the Tech News Today. Subscribe to Tech News Today on YouTube. Choose your favorite way to subscribe at twit.tv/TNT. Follow us on Twitter. Tech News Today TV is our Twitter name. And please send us your thoughts and opinions by sending email to tnt@twit.tv or calling us at 260-TNT-SHOW. And don't miss our evening newscast, Tech News Tonight at 4 p.m. Pacific tonight and every weeknight right here on the Twit Network. My name is Mike Elgan. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you tomorrow, 1 hour early at 9 a.m. Pacific, noon Eastern. And just after the show, our special coverage of the live Apple event will take place starting at around 9:30 p.m. A.M. Pacific. That's 9:30 a.m. Pacific. Don't come in at night. We won't be here. And that's with Leo, Sarah, and me. You don't want to miss that. Take care, and we'll see you tomorrow.